Thank you. That concludes the debate on retail and town centres in Scotland. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is an urgent question, and I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for what reason the Constitution Secretary reportedly referred to the statistic that Scotland has 25% of Europe's offshore wind resources at a meeting with European delegates on the 4th of October and in newspaper columns of 17th and 18th of October 2022, in light of an email indicating that officials had advised him that the statistic was inaccurate on the 28th of September 2022.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson. Can we please have the Cabinet Secretary's microphone? Can I just ask you to check that your card is in, Cabinet Secretary? We'll just... Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's a matter of fact, and I hope not of party political disagreement, that Scotland is exceptionally well endowed with renewable energy potential. As renewable technologies, licensing rounds and completed schemes develop at home and abroad, so does the statistical context. An example of this is last year's ScotWind licensing round, which was the world's largest ever leasing round for floating offshore wind, with developer ambitions at over 17 gigawatts. The statistic the member highlights has been used by both the UK and the Scottish governments, but is now considered to be overtaken by developments. That's why I am no longer using the statistic. The Scottish Government has committed to provide Parliament with updated statistics in due course, and I am confident that it will confirm that Scotland is well placed to be a significant European leader in renewable energy production, and I hope that the member will join me in using them to promote Scotland at home and abroad.
Liam Kerr.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for completely evading the question that I asked. Cabinet Secretary, I have an FOI that says that he presented this statistic as a fact on the 4th of October to foreign politicians. So, since foreign politicians and the people of Scotland in his columns on the 17th and 18th of October were potentially misled by the Cabinet Secretary, what action has the Cabinet Secretary taken to ensure the foreign politicians know what the truth is, to ensure that he's tracked down and corrected anyone else to whom he has repeated the misleading statistic, and to establish which of his other colleagues have similarly repeated the misleading statistic, so they too can ensure they were giving out accurate information?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The Scottish and the UK governments are no longer using the statistics that have been overtaken by developments. However, I think it's really important not to inadvertently create the impression that Scotland is not a nation with significant renewable resources. It has immense natural resources. So when projects which are awaiting construction, under construction, or already operational are added to the current reported potential pipeline, the total potential capacity reaches over 40 gigawatts, the equivalent to produce enough electricity annually to power every home in Scotland for 17 years or every home in the UK for over a year and a half.
Liam Kerr.
There is appalling disrespect for this Parliament in the Cabinet Secretary's refusal to answer or even address the question that I have put. And there's a bigger picture here, of course, around what this says about this government. Because on 8th of November 2022, I asked Minister Lorna Slater, when did ministers first become aware they were using a figure that, to quote Scottish Government officials, had not been properly sourced? She said, ministers became aware of the issue on Tuesday, the 8th of November. In an email dated the 16th of November 2022, the Cabinet Secretary wrote to his constituent, ministers became aware on the 8th of November that it, the 25% statistic, was not an accurate figure. Cabinet Secretary emailed me last week stating, and I quote, officials emailed advice to my private office against using the 25% statistic on the 28th September 2022, which suggests that the information he gave to his constituent was not correct. Presiding Officer, at page 41, under the heading Honesty of the Ministerial Code, it says, holders of public office should be truthful. At section 1.3c, it says, ministers who knowingly mislead the Parliament will be expected to offer their resignation to the First Minister. Presiding Officer, given that these circumstances I have detailed suggest there have been major breaches of this code, when will the Cabinet Secretary and Minister Lorna Slater be tendering their resignations in disgrace?
Cabinet Secretary.
It was an interesting speech rather than a question, wasn't it? The statistic, and I'll say it again for the member's benefit, who was just keen to read out what he had written before he arrived in the chamber, clearly. The statistic that the member highlights has been used by both the UK and the Scottish governments. It is now considered to be overtaken by developments. That
Thank
is why
you,
I'm no
members.
Longer using this statistic. I've also made clear in an earlier answer to him, and I'm sorry that he doesn't seem that that's good enough, the Scottish Government is committed to provide Parliament with the updated statistics in due course. I hope he'll join me in using them to promote the renewable sector in Scotland.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary was advised by his own officials in September, not once but twice, not to use the 25% figure. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us why he ignored that advice when pushing the bogus stats to a French government minister? Then he doubled down by citing these dodgy figures in newspaper columns and in speeches. Why did he do that? Why did he ignore that advice? And given how important the principle of truthfulness is within the ministerial code, should he not refer himself for investigation under that code?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I just point out to the member that the potential of Scotland's massive renewable energy is recognised internationally, especially amongst our northern European neighbours. Can I say to
Excuse
Colin Smith...
Excuse me, Cabinet Secretary, can I just ask members to ensure that we are all able to hear members when they are speaking? Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member asked the question and then just proceeded to barrack me. If he will allow me to...
Continue, please.
I should continue. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I say to Colin Smith that his colleague in the Norwegian Labour Party, Andreas Bjellan Eriksson, the State Secretary for Energy... Well, I'm sorry that Colin Smith isn't interested in this, because his colleague in Norway most certainly was. I met him at the beginning of this month in Tromsø, and him and his colleagues are extremely keen to cooperate with Scotland because they recognise that both of our countries have so much renewable energy potential. I agree that we want statistics to be as up-to-date as possible, and I hope that Colin Smith will join me in using them to promote renewables potential, the investment and the jobs it will bring, and make our contribution to combat the climate crisis.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Nobody in this chamber is disputing that Scotland has tremendous offshore renewable generation potential. What we are disputing is the bogus statistics which artificially inflate that statistic on the world stage. Now, twice we've seen some fancy footwork from the Cabinet Secretary trying to say that this statistic has been overtaken by developments, in his words. But the fact is, if that development he's talking about is the realisation that this figure was in fact always mince, then he is quite right. This was a mashup of reports and academic research going back to 1991, which excluded the renewable powerhouse of Scandinavia. And we have raised this several times and time again. In fact, I challenged both First Minister and Lorna Slater on this figure when they told me it was outdated, when it was in fact never true. They dodged my parliamentary questions, asking them to correct the record within the requisite time, and that correction has never been lodged. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, why are there no consequences for any of these ministers, including him? Does accuracy, transparency and accountability, both in Parliament and on the international stage, matter so little to this government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I just point out to the Liberal Democrats that this is a statistic that was used by the UK government, I think I'm right in saying a government that included Liberal Democrats. The member is absolutely right to say we should aspire to the best statistics we can have. That is what we're working towards, and I hope he and the representatives of other parties will do everything to promote renewables around Europe and the rest of the world, rather than trying to undermine Scotland's reputation.
Mm-hmm. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary not understand that Scotland's renewable wind potential does not need made-up or exaggerated statistics, and that by doing so, he and his government undermine Scotland's natural resources reputation?
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to assume that the member is not aware that it's a statistic that was used by a Conservative-led United Kingdom government. This is a statement. That is a statement of fact. It's also a statement of fact that statistics need to be updated. That's exactly what's going to happen. And I hope he and everybody else in the Chamber will use that to promote Scotland at home and abroad.
Thank you. That concludes the urgent question. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 8062 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to this week's business. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
I move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. I call on Stephen Kerr to speak to and move amendment 8062.1.
Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name. And yes, I am trying everything I can, because I would have thought that members on all sides of this chamber would want the issue of the teacher strike properly aired in our nation's parliament. What is this parliament for if it isn't to address the major issues of today? The people of Scotland are watching and listening. And today, right across Scotland, pupils are not at school, and parents and carers are doing their best to cope with yet another day of disruption. Haven't our young people had enough disruption to their education over the past 3 years? And yet this SNP government won't agree to send a minister to this chamber to make a statement and to answer questions. Is it so unreasonable to expect the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, or the Deputy First Minister, because he's the one that's really running this shambolic operation, to come to the Chamber to make a statement and answer questions? But this government doesn't want to send the hapless Shirley Ann Somerville anywhere near this Chamber to answer a statement or make a statement or answer questions.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. He makes a lot of noise. Has he got a proposal to solve this problem?
Stephen Kerr.
Well, John Mason asked, do I have a proposal? Yes, it's to amend the business motion so that we can have a statement and questions tomorrow.
Alec Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Stephen Kerr for giving way. John Mason asked, does he have a proposal to offer? If, as I know, members of the Stephen Kerr party joined me in meeting EIS reps up at the National Poetry Library this afternoon, they told that all of the talks that are conducted by Shirley Ann Somerville and John Swinney contain absolutely nothing new other than there is no more money, what would you like us to cut?
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful to the members for their interventions. I agree with Ash Reagan. Ash Reagan said Shirley Ann Somerville is not now listening to the concerns of teachers and parents. Shirley Ann Somerville has lectured me, she's lectured all of us, about how she wasn't going to negotiate with the teachers' representatives because that isn't how negotiations are done. But what do we hear this morning on BBC Radio Scotland? The same Shirley Ann Somerville telling us that she and John Swinney were finally going to negotiate with the EIS. I give way to Michael Mara.
Michael Mara.
Thank the member for giving way. Does he share Labour's concerns about the... I'm glad that he will. Regarding the number of young people in targeted constituencies in the ministers of this government who are losing extra days of education, does he think the minister should be in front of this parliament telling us what accommodation can be made to make sure they receive the grades and support that they require?
Stephen Absolutely Kerr. Agree with Michael Mara. I absolutely agree. Because suddenly it's a done thing for the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to go to the negotiation table just as they've been asking for months. And given the way that Nicola Sturgeon praised her favourite Hamza Yousaf for preventing strikes in the NHS, because he was on top of his job, if anyone believed that, I actually feel sorry for Shirley Ann Somerville, because clearly her boss thinks that she's not up to her job, and that's probably why John Swinney has been at the table with the EIS. I don't think I have any time. Perhaps you would, Perhaps you would like to listen to what one parent wrote to me. I am writing to express my extreme disappointment and frustration at the ongoing strike action by teachers. As a parent to S5 and S6 children sitting final year exams, I am deeply concerned about the impact this is having on my children's education and their future prospects. I am particularly dismayed at the apparent lack of progress in resolving the teachers' pay dispute. It's unacceptable that our children's education should be disrupted in this way. And I urge you all to do everything in your power to bring this situation to a swift and satisfactory conclusion. I'm also concerned about the Scottish Government's handling of this issue. It is clear that additional resources are needed to support our children through this turbulent period, and I would like to know what steps the Government is taking to address this. I could go on, but I respect the fact I could go on because there's a lot more that parents have written to me to express their concern about the disruption to their children's education that might not mean very much to SNP members. It means a great deal to Scotland's parents and carers. There's lots that could be said on this subject. There are many questions that need to be asked. What is the SNP government doing to bring this dispute to an end? Other than endlessly repeating, as the Cabinet Secretary did this morning on the radio, how terribly disappointing it all is. What is the contingency plan to support pupils facing important exams? What plans are in place to ensure that the exam timetable is not disrupted? What is the contingency plan to get exam papers marked? This isn't scaremongering, Presiding Officer.
You must
it's
conclude, Mr.
what
Kerr.
We're facing. I'll just conclude. How can we credibly look the parents, young people and teachers of Scotland in the face when their Parliament isn't even prepared to hold this SNP Cabinet Secretary to account for this unfolding mess?
Thank you, and I call on George Adam to respond on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau.
Well, thank you, Presiding Officer, and whoever thought I would be the calm cooling effect in any debate, but here we are, and I'd like to remind members that possibly when we're talking about Bureau and future business, Mr Kerr's outburst has nothing to do with the subject matter, nothing to do with the current negotiations. Mr Kerr asks what will actually solve the current issues with the union. Cool heads, Presiding Officer. That's what's going to beating your chest and shouting and bawling in this chamber will not do that. And I'd also encourage Mr Kerr to talk to his business manager. He knows how the system works. As you know, Presiding Officer, the Parliamentary Business Bureau is set up so that we can have these discussions and make sure that we have the discussions regarding parliamentary business and not just automatically drag it to decision time at 5 o'clock in the evening. But Parliamentary Bureau is the ideal forum for these discussions. And with regard to the actual issue that Mr Kerr, I think he kind of said what he said last week. But
can I just ask, Minister, if you could just... yes, thank you. There's conversation going on across the aisles, and I'd be really grateful if we could just get out of this habit, because I'm seeing it on too many occasions. Can we please hear the Minister? Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. But I think we finally heard through Mr Kerr what he was saying was something very similar to last week, and my answer would be I would refer him to my answer I gave him last week, which is discussions are ongoing, negotiations remain at a sensitive and critical stage, and a statement would therefore not be appropriate at this time. But in closing, Presiding Officer, the Deputy First Minister and the Cabinet Secretary, both cool heads, are speaking with the unions at this very moment.
Thank you. The first question is that Amendment 8062.1, in the name of Stephen Kerr, which seeks to amend Motion 8062, in the name of George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, on changes to this week's business, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting. Today's pin is...